Hi there, I'm Maria Jesus, a graduate student and botanist at California Botanic Garden. CalBG is the largest garden dedicated to California native plants. Our team works every day in research, conservation, and public engagement to ensure a future for the plants that call California home. When I say biodiversity, you may conjure images of toucans, jewel-toned frogs, and jaguars in the lush jungles of the Amazon's tropical rainforest. However, you may be surprised to discover that your own backyard might actually be a biodiversity hotspot. Scientists have a word for biodiverse places that face acute challenges in today's modernizing industrial world. Biodiversity hotspot. To qualify as a hotspot, a region must contain at least 1,500 vascular plant species as endemics, meaning these plants are found nowhere else in the world, and that they have lost at least 70% of their primary vegetation. Globally, 36 places have been designated as hotspots. Remarkably, these represent only 2.3% of the Earth's surface, but are estimated to contain more than 50% of the Earth's vascular plant species. What you may not have realized is that California is a biodiversity hotspot. An incredible number of plants and animal species call this remarkable place home. Isn't it amazing that your own home is part of a biodiversity hotspot? Plants and animals typically don't obey human boundaries. The outlines of California don't define the range of what scientists consider the California floristic province. This region includes southern Oregon, a small portion of Nevada, and northern Baja California. What makes California a biodiversity hotspot? Well, for starters, the California floristic province has over 8,000 species of native plants. 61% of them are endemic. The state of California itself has over 7,700 minimum rank vascular plant taxa, species, subspecies, and varieties, of which 85% are native and 30% are endemic. More than three-fourths of their original habitat has been lost to urban development and agriculture. Approximately one-third of the state's native flora are of special concern, and nearly 4% are state or federally listed as rare, threatened, or endangered. The diversity and distribution of plants on the landscape are influenced by both biotic, meaning living, and abiotic, meaning non-living factors. Biotic factors include seed dispersal, pollinators, and natural enemies like herbivores. Abiotic factors include rainfall, temperature, sunlight, soils, and topography. California's floristic richness is largely attributed to the state's geologic, topographic, and climatic complexity. Let's look closer at the abiotic factors that have influenced California's exceptionally high plant diversity. California has a diverse climate ranging from wet, temperate rainforests in the north to hot, arid deserts in the interior and south, and snowy alpine climates in the mountains. But it is the Mediterranean climate of wet, mild winters and hot, dry summers that dominates the rest of the state. Only four other areas in the world have a Mediterranean climate. The mild conditions of the Mediterranean climate contribute to the unusually high plant diversity and endemism found in these regions. California is a land of extremes, and topography is no exception. The highest is Mount Whitney at 14,494 feet, and the lowest is Death Valley at negative 282 feet. Oh, and they're only 75 miles apart. Topography is intricately tied to geology and soils. Thanks to plate tectonics, California is one of the most geologically complex places in the world and includes active volcanoes, granitic batholiths, alluvium, limestone, dolomite, and serpentine. Of the 12 soil orders recognized in the world, California has 10. Some plant species are broadly distributed across the landscape, while others have very narrow, restricted ranges. Niche breadth, the range of environmental conditions a species can tolerate or utilize, shapes the distribution of plants. Sagebrush has a broad distribution. The shrub is native to California, but also occurs more broadly across the western U.S. In contrast, some plants have restricted distributions. For example, the Catalina Island mountain mahogany is endemic to Catalina Island, with only 7 plants growing in the wild. California is known for its high levels of endemism, of which there are several types. Paleoendemics, or relic taxa, persistent spatially restricted climates that were once more widespread. Neo-endemics are species that have evolved recently and whose origins are likely tied to the uplift of mountain ranges and aridification of the climate over the last 2 to 5 million years. Edaphic endemics are species restricted to a particular bedrock or soil type. A special kind of edaphic endemic are serpentine endemics, plants restricted to soils composed mainly of iron magnesium silicate and usually toxic to most other plants. Vernal pool endemics are restricted to temporary wetlands underlain by an impermeable soil or rock layer. Where a plant grows has important consequences for its morphology. For example, plants that grow in the desert have specific morphological adaptations, such as succulents or CAM photosynthesis, to cope with low precipitation, droughts, and extremely high temperatures. But what happens when a plant's environment changes? How does a plant respond then? Some of the ways in which we see the habitat of California's native plant species being impacted are population growth, urban development, and invasive species. Climate change poses a serious threat to biodiversity. In the last century, mean global surface temperatures have increased by nearly 1 degree Celsius. In the next century, our mean global temperatures could increase by about 4 degrees Celsius, which could mean an increase in the frequency of heat waves, storms, and fires. California is already amidst climactic chaos. Our climate is getting drier, rainfall is more sporadic, snowpack is declining, and as is all too familiar, our fire season is longer, more frequent, and more devastating. In the face of climate change and other environmental challenges, what choices do our native plants have? Which species will be most affected? How will these shifts affect pollinators, pathogens, and pests? And which habitats and vegetation types are most sensitive? Plants have essentially 3 choices. They can migrate, they can undergo adaptive evolutionary change, or if the rate of change exceeds the pace at which plants can respond, then individual plants, populations, or even whole species may go extinct. Already we are seeing widespread declines in populations of the iconic Joshua tree due to a changing climate. We anticipate that the impact of climate change will be complex and diverse, affecting biodiversity on a multitude of levels. Further complicating matters, differences in life history and ecological attributes may lead species to respond differently to the same changes. One way we can measure impacts of climate change on California's native plants is through species distribution modeling. Using herbarium specimen information, climate data, and modeling tools, we can construct climate-based distribution models to estimate the future distribution of species. Another way we can measure impact is by measuring phenology, the timing of seasonal life stages, such as flowering and fruiting times. Phenology not only affects the fitness of plants, but also the fitness of the organisms that depend on them, including mating patterns, gene flow, and evolution. Mismatches in the timing between plants and pollinators can influence evolutionary shifts, agricultural productivity, and even cause populations to go extinct. The California Phenology Network, a consortium of 28 participating herbaria, aims to digitize over 1 million herbarium specimens of California native plants and score their phenology. These will increase our understanding of the direction and magnitude of phenological shifts of California's flora. Understanding and predicting responses through modeling approaches and phenological scoring of plant specimens is key to developing and guiding policy decisions at local and regional levels that in turn will help to preserve and protect California's unique plant diversity.